So you're going to let me know when you're ready?
Ah, I'm fucking giving you a thumbs up. I'm giving you the fucking thumbs up.
I switched onto the script so I can't see your fucking face.
The script? Fuck off. You've got no script.
Hello and welcome to the Movie Chef Podcast, where we make a meal out of movies and serve a cinematic feast for your indulgence. I am your host, Chef Tebbs, and with me again is the man who believes that tears should only be used at funerals and on the Giant's Causeway. It's Cormac. How are you doing today, Cormac?
Not too bad, my man, not too bad. They charge you. Nice little trust, they charge. You remember the argument we had with the woman?
It's rocks. How much do you want to charge? £15.
It's a wonder of the world, Paul. All right.
And they just happened to build a visitor center right on the road to get to see that wonder of the world. It was very, very clever of them. But I can't believe we walked.
We don't have miles. A lot.
We don't what?
We don't have that much, Paul. We have Game of Thrones. We have bombs, and we have Giant's Causeway.
And you have hexagonal stones. That's it. But no, so usual question, you've been out much, you've been up to much, or just in the house?
In the house, rocking a what do you call it, house coat, as my missus calls it.
Your dressing gown.
I prefer to call it a dinner jacket.
The smoking jacket without the smoke.
There's
still been happenings in Hollywood. Seen as though, even though there's a lockdown going on, stuff's still going on. Have you been keeping up to date with that? Have you seen much of the news that's happening?
I've seen a few things.
The story came out a couple of weeks back that AMC Cinemas in America, they've got over 600 cinemas covering 8,000 screens. They've announced that they're no longer going to be showing Universal films in their screens from now on. Due to the, basically what happened was one of the Universal head honchos said, due to the success of Trolls on Video On Demand, taking in over $100 million, we might have to look again about how films are distributed. And straight away, the guy from AMC has thrown his open letter out there to Hollywood and said, if you're going to play like that, then we're not going to bother showing you films at all. What do you think about that? Do you think they should come straight on video on demand, or do you think cinemas should get an exclusivity first?
It's difficult now that everything is kind of on demand. Obviously, we're kind of being hampered by the situation that we're in socially. But I don't believe... I'm not one of these cinephile people that just believes that, you know, a movie is only a movie if you're watching it on the big screen and you're, just encompassing everything. You know, I'm not one of these people whatsoever. I watch most of my movies on my phone. Me and the missus don't have near enough the same taste in movies. So she usually takes the TV and I take a phone. I can understand the push of trying to get people to spend money on demand, but surely, you know, they would make a lot more money through cinema wise. You know, there are a lot more people walking through the doors of a cinema. But forgive me for being ignorant, but Universal, you know, what are we talking about? What movies, you know, would be affected?
Over the next year, you're looking at, you've got Bond, No Time to Die.
Ooh.
That's still going to come out. You're talking probably $1 billion there. You got Halloween Kills, the sequel to the Halloween reboot that came out a couple of years back.
Another one?
And you got another two. I think it's there's Halloween Kills, and I'm pretty sure it's something like Halloween Kills Again or something shite like that.
And is Tommy Lee Curtis in this, and Jimmy Lee Curtis, and
Jamie Lee's
Lee
back?
Curtis, and
okay. I don't know. I think they might have announced Jamie Lee's back for the next two. I'm not too sure, but if they've done that, then the second one.
Unless it's True Lies 2, I'm not interested.
No, not interested. Move along. But yeah, they've also got that. They've got Fast and Furious 9 with
ooh.
Mr. Showtime himself, John Cena, Vin Diesel, etc. No, The Rock this time. But Fast and Furious 9, you're probably talking another 1.2, 1.4 billion. So, yeah. And there was another one, Jurassic World 3 or Jurassic Park 6 or whatever you want to call it. That one's due out next summer, I think. So you're talking a good, just in those films, you're talking a good 5 billion. So I think they'd be crazy to do it, but I can understand where they're coming from. As soon as you put a film on video on demand, we've both just, well, I'm going to say it as well, I'd much prefer to sit in my house. I don't want to watch films with strangers. I love it. I love the big screen. I love the experience. But I don't like sitting next to strangers watching my films and having to travel 20 minutes to get there. So if it were on my telly, I'd sit and watch it. I was looking into the what the studios charge cinemas. And I think cinemas take around 50% of the ticket value from what a film takes over the counter. Star Wars, they can demand 60%, for example. But you've got to think with the video on demand, the money needed is a lot less. You've got people like, you know, Xbox, Amazon, all these people who will take their cut, but nowhere will it be 50%. So it might be more profitable for them to do that in the future. But I can understand cinemas getting scared because you take away the exclusivity, you just slash how many customers you've got coming through the door.
But would it not, like, I know personally, I have used the old adage of, well, it'll be on Netflix in a year's time. Well, it'll be on Amazon Prime in a year's time. You know, does it not then hold people back from actually paying for it on the TV and going, oh, you know what, it's going to be on Netflix in 6 months' time. I'll not pay for it at all. And, you know, so it's a lose. Well, it's either win-win or lose-lose for someone.
Someone's always going to lose out, but we'll see. We'll see how it goes. It's just one thing that's happening. I know Odeon and Cineworld over here are co-owned by some of them companies. I don't know exactly which ones, to be honest. And between me and you and whoever's listening, I couldn't be bothered reading up on it. But they are all linked together. So that will have a knock-on effect over here should those cinemas decide to do that. Fact is, your Odeon, Cineworld, View, whoever says, yeah, we'll hold them, is going to have that them key releases all to themselves, which they're going to snap their hand off for. So, Star Wars news. I think there's always Star Wars news every week. Taika Waititi has signed up to direct and co-write a new standalone Star Wars film. I think you're not keen.
There is obviously massive Star Wars fatigue within the world. I think me and you have had numerous conversations about Star Wars over the last number of years. Obviously the main one has been the last three that have been released. So correct me if I'm no, well, maybe not Solo. I'm not going to talk about Solo. But
why
Rogue One? Well, you know what? I don't think it's as bad as what everybody made it out to be. I thought Donald Glover was great. You know, they tried to shoehorn a lot of stuff into it. You could tell at the point of where the directors changed as well, because, you know, they tried to add new characters in and keep adding them in, and it was kind of like, oh, God, you know, what are they trying to do here? My main, obviously, gripe has been with, you know, Last Jedi and Rise of Skywalker. Last Jedi, I went to see in the cinema, and within 30 seconds, I knew that I wasn't going to like it. You know, and I go into Star Wars movies with an open mind. I went into Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones, Revenge of the Sith, all with an open mind, and actually came out of each one of those movies thinking, you know what, that actually wasn't that bad. You know, later on when you get a little bit older and you look at it and you start talking about fucking trade federations and all that jazz, you know, you know, you start looking at it going, fuck me, why did I actually like this as a kid? But, you know, Last Jedi, when I left the cinema, I felt as if I'd been violated. I felt as if, you know, somebody had ripped me Chewie toy from my hand, bit his head off and threw it on the ground. And that's exactly how I felt. And, you know, it was lose-lose in Rise of Skywalker. You know, they tried to get caught back. They tried to get as much stuff back into it as possible, but it was gone at that point. You know, it was gone.
The one thing that stood out for me with the first thing I thought when I saw Taika Waititi was signing up to a film is, he's writing the script, good. He's writing it with another screenwriter. Again, forgive me, I don't have the name in front of me. But it's going to be his project, and if he is kept on that project, they understand what he's going to be doing, and he sticks with it, then it'll be, for me, it'll be great. If you've seen the Mandalorian season finale, it surely can handle Star Wars.
Yeah, but I think the main problem when it comes to Star Wars is, you know, there's far too many cooks in Star Wars, and whoever is in charge of them, no matter who it is and no matter how much creative freedom that they say they're going to get, they don't get that creative freedom.
All I'm saying is that right now, pinch of salt, hopefully he'll be given that chance to write a script. And, okay, so let's assume he's given that freedom to make his own film. He's going to write it. He's going to see it through. He's going to edit it. It's going to be his film. What do you want to see? Do you want to see Old Republic? Do you want to see something still set within the Skywalker years, but another offshoot story? What would be your Taika Waititi film?
I think it's difficult because the main crux of the argument between all this Last Jedi and Rise of Skywalker stuff, and why some people were annoyed about the Jedi temples and were, you know, it meant nothing, and you know, fuck that. Who cares? You know, it doesn't mean fuck all to anybody apart from, you know, people that just get annoyed about nothing. You know, I would love if they'd done the Old Republic stuff, you know, the Thawne stuff. I would love them to do something.
Yep.
To do with that, you know, where we're creeping into though is, I don't want to use the term, but it's the kind of bastardization of comedy that's been put through Marvel now. Just because Guardians of the Galaxy was a funny, good movie, they've tried to make every Marvel movie a funny, good movie. You know, now there have been some fantastic Marvel movies, you know, more fantastic movies than you know, average or bad. But I want to see a Star Wars movie that has a story. I want to see a Star Wars movie that has heart. And I want to see a Star Wars movie that has a start, a middle, and an end, because that last series didn't have one. No.
And the thing from, that's why I'm saying I want Waititi to stay on, keep his project, because I can name all the films, that Star Wars films, that have disappointed me recently. Rogue One to an extent.
No, you're mental!
Rogue One to an extent. Rise of Skywalker, Solo. They were all films which were, like you said, there were too many cooks that changed directors halfway through, or with Rise of Skywalker, it was supposed to be Colin Trevorrow that was up first, and then he got changed at the end back to Abrams. And like you say, if it's one person's story and one person's vision, and they tell the story of the one, I personally think Waititi would make great. After seeing the Mandalorian season finale, I was surprised that was him, to be honest, because I didn't even click. I didn't even notice it was him directing that. But you could tell in certain aspects, there were certain bits of that, his irreverent humour that were coming through. But I don't want it to be...
Maybe I sound like a bitter old man. I don't want no fucking comedy. I want lightsabers. And I want heart. And I want people crying because things die.
And I want midichlorians lined up against the wall.
Midichlorians. What happened to the Trade Federation?
So what about staying in space? Nice little segue there, do you think? Staying in space, Tom Cruise has announced... Tom Cruise has announced that he wants to make a new action film set and filmed in space. Now.
Right. First of all.
You go first. Who gives a fuck?
You. First Gravity of all. Looked amazing. Gravity was amazing. Gravity was outstanding.
Have you seen Ad Astra?
I haven't, no. I've seen the posters as good as watching
them. The posters look fantastic. The film looks fantastic. The film looks gorgeous. 2001 A Space Odyssey. Let's go back 40, 50 years. Jesus, I just think there's kids out there sick. There's people hungry. And you're going to take
another battleship Potemkin.
Set in space. And everyone's going to look going... Wow, he's really floating around there. It looks just like the CGI does. I just think, fucking hell, why don't you just take, you know, you look at some films sometimes, you look at a film, I don't know, you know, Battleship. Do you remember when that came out with Liam Neeson and it was on the board game Battleships? with Liam Neeson and Rihanna making a big Hollywood break.
Yes. Yes.
Basically, you look at a film like that, you saw that they spent $200 million on it, and you just think, you could have just taken that money and fed and clothed the hungry and homeless. Could have just taken that money, never made that film. No one's life would have been any worse off for that film not being made, and you could have fed and clothed people. And I just think when I see stuff like
this, we're living in a world where Elon Musk put a Tesla in space.
Course he did.
Why?
Course he did. And I bet that one caught fire as well. So right. Anyway, there's the news. There's all what's happening, and I'm sure as more things happen, we'll be able to rant and discuss it to our hearts' content. So, moving on to today, we are serving up a chef special, aren't we, Cormac?
We are indeed.
He's excited for this one. And if you follow us on Twitter at PodMovieChef, then you will already know what it is. This is a film close to our hearts. It's got a hearty serving of action, sprinkled with comedy and some delicate romance on the side. More twists than a M. Night Shyamalan on a waltzer. This is Hudson Hawk.
This summer, Bruce Willis is back in business.
Thanks for saving me, tough guy.
And business is booming.
I was afraid you weren't going to drop by.
Hudson Hawk.
That excites me.
Check, please.
The best cat burglar that ever lived.
I didn't want to do it. All I wanted was a cappuccino.
But he can't retire.
Maybe nobody told you. I quit stealing.
If he wants to keep on living.
This is a brand new tuxedo!
Watch your step. Hold your breath. Hang on for dear life. And catch the Hawk.
Good plan, Junior.
Bruce Willis, Danny Aiello, Andy McDowell, Hudson Hawk.
Sounds like a party.
Let me get this out of the way from the start for everybody listening. This movie is fucking awesome.
Yes.
It is 1991 Hudson Hawk, the Bruce Willis vehicle. It is comedy. It is romance. It's drama. It is action. There are twists. I honest to God, I cannot think of another movie from my childhood that I hold in such high regard than Hudson Hawk.
I hate to deviate just from Hudson Hawk for a second, but what a year for Bruce Willis, because Die Hard 2 came out, and then Last Boy Scout came out, and then Hudson Hawk came out. What a year. Like, that's an amazing year.
I've got to say, looking back, and you just think, Bruce Willis, it was just around that time, everything he was doing, he was knocking it out of the park. He was absolutely knocking it out of the park. Die Hard, like I say, Last Boy Scout. His later career we'll put to one side, but right this minute, this was prime, prime Philly Willis.
Yeah. It was big Willis. Yeah,
big hand in the story of this. He wanted it to be very much around his sort of New York, New Jersey roots, a bit of a crime caper. I was watching this the other night again for about the thousandth time. I would like to put it out there that if the Americans were to make a James Bond film, they would make Hudson Hawk. The villain, the lair, the grand scheme to take over the world, the hero. I mean, yeah, they won't have him as a spy, they'd have him as a convicted cat burglar, but you get where I'm coming from. This, for me, is just everything about Bond and dialed up to 100. It's fantastic.
I think it's different the way that movies mean for you. I think we spoke last week about some of the movies that we talk, and it was around 92-93 when Sky Television became, you know, the staple in the UK, and Sky Movies obviously came with every package. And it was around that time that me and my brother just wanted to watch as much Americana as humanly possible. We wanted to watch everything, you know. Obviously, we would have to stay up late at night so our parents wouldn't know about it. And we would sneak into the living room and watch. I remember we used to watch V, and then after V was Sledgehammer, which was like the most amazing double bill that you'll ever get.
I remember I've been introduced to Sledgehammer by my pal Johnny. That guy is awesome. That guy's gonna narrate my future. But I always remember, and again, back in the old days, kids, Saturday night, 10 o'clock was Sky Movies premiere, or Sky Movies One, or whatever they used to call it. And the premieres, the weekly premiere, the one new film they'd put on each week, would be Saturday night, 10 o'clock. My parents would be out. I was waiting for it for about 3 months. We had the TV guide in the week before, and I was waiting for Hudson Hawk to come on just so I could come and enjoy it. And oh god, what a film! Where do we start? From the beginning. We meet Eddie, convicted cat burglar Dan Aiello. I mean, I'm not going to profess to being his biggest fan, but this was a role made for him. This was a real absolutely amazing.
R.I.P. man. December. We lost Aniello in December.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And even then I think I watched Hudson Hawk again just in his honor and his memory. But yeah, Eddie and Tommy Five Tone heading into New Jersey, and straight away we get one of the antagonists of the film, the Mario Brothers. And you know what? I'm gonna keep referring back to this. All Eddie wants, all Hudson wants, is his cappuccino. And I love that the thing that keeps this story going is him needing a damn cappuccino. But we meet them. We got a nice little cameo, if you want to call it that, from Frank Stallone, Sly's brother. So we've got them in
there. Did you want to go back and relive some of Frank Stallone's albums when you watched this movie again? Did you know that Frank Stallone was a musician?
You have just cracked an egg of knowledge right on my head there. Frank Stallone.
Oh, Paul. Not only did Frank Stallone make some of the greatest music ever, but, you know, he was involved in movies such as Staying Alive with John Travolta, the Rocky movies, obviously, with his brother, and, of course, Over the Top. You know, there's a lot of movies that Frank Stallone did music for.
I'm going to go back and revisit. What is he like? Is it like the sort of, what is it, jazz and all that? Or is he more rock and stuff?
It was very much like a disco kind of kind of feeling to it. But if anybody's listening to this and you haven't seen Staying Alive, the sequel to Saturday Night Fever, I would implore you to go watch it. I would implore you to get that album as well and listen to it. It is fantastic.
Just again, another thing. I'm gonna go back and have a listen to that now. I didn't even know that was Frank Stallone. I always knew him as Sylvester's brother. I thought they just wheeled him in for this film. There you go. And then we've got him obviously being dragged into the first the auction house theft. I mean, again, I've seen Ocean's 11. Okay, I've seen the Rat Pack version and the Clooney version. I've seen, God, you know, my eyes going totally blank, but I've seen plenty of heist films. Plenty of, who can forget Entrapment with Sean Connery? But,
of course,
outstanding. Absolute genius. I mean, if you're going to time it, why bother relying on a watch? You know, why
not swinging on a star? Why not?
Why not swinging on a star? Dean Martin or the legend Frank Sinatra. But why not sing as you're going around the auction house? And again, it's another layer to it. It's another layer that shows these guys what they're doing. This guy is an intelligent guy. He's got the crack. He knows what he's doing. And he's going to be in and out of that auction house. Obviously, things don't go to plan. And we end up coming across... I forgot the butler's name. What's the butler's name? I've seen the film 1,000 times. I've forgotten the butler's name. It's probably Alfred.
No, it wasn't Alfred. I do have it written down here somewhere. It is Alfred.
Is it? That's probably why I'm remembering it. But we've got him.
I did find out a weird fact about him. Not much about him. I hate looking up. I hate Googling stuff. But I wanted to try and get something of a smaller character within this movie, right? And yeah. One of the things that I stumbled upon, the guy who plays Alfred, Donald Burton, R.I.P., dead a long time now.
Yeah, yeah.
But his wife was... was the evil grandmother in Kindergarten Cop. So he was married to that girl in real life. Remember at the end of the movie? Remember at the end of the movie where Schwarzenegger's in the shower and the really weird, creepy-looking guy?
Yeah, right, okay.
They were married.
Fucking hell. Right. Did you ever see a Richard Greco film called... Teen Agent,
or something. Yes.
Have you seen it with the? Or it's called The Secret in Her Eyes or The Secret in My Eyes in America.
It was around that time where like Richard Greco was, you know, like 21 Jump Street, and it was all into Michael J. Fox, you know, Teen Wolf and things.
Back when he still had his own face.
That's not nice.
But yeah, I always remember that. In fact, I think I want to go back and watch that one again. But no, so he was married to... God, right, okay. I didn't even realise that one. And we get... we come then to the auction house again where they revisit it the next morning. And I tell you what, you can take your Darth Vaders and Hannibal Lecters and... I mean, I mentioned Bond earlier.
What an entrance.
What an entrance. Please, just describe it for us.
Well, Fred Elliott is behind the gavel up in the auction room.
Yes!
And
Fred Elliott, man from CSI Miami is in the crowd.
Yeah, David Caruso. The bid is at like $20 million. And then, of course... Grant just comes in and 100 million clams!
Like a fucking tornado. He is fantastic. Yeah. And you know what? I've read some stuff. And we're not being negative about this because I'm not. But I've read some stuff about this film. I've read quotes from his autobiography. Yeah. Apparently, Richard didn't have a great time filming this film. Apparently, a few bits Richard looks back on. Not good times. But you know what? He fucking earns his money.
Was totally missed for me was that Richard E. Grant, yes, he said that he didn't particularly like filming the movie. When he watched it, you know, he said that, you know, he thought that he'd never work again and all this stuff. But the one overriding factor is he steals every scene that he's in.
Oh God, yeah.
If I'm watching that movie, and yeah, I think a lot of his, you know, his history of Hudson Hawk is solely based on his interactions with maybe Bruce Willis and maybe the director Lehman, and you know, and the fact that it was kind of a bit chaotic, you know, I find it hard to believe that Richard E. Grant. And how he comes across in this movie. And, you know, I've read some... He was nominated for a Razzie. What?
Nah. Well, you know, stupid. Razzies are for people in Hollywood that are never going to win Academy Awards. They're voted for... That, for me, is that. They're just a bunch of people who are never going to get to the big table. They're never going to go out with the cool kids. So they just rip the piss out of... all the cool people out there. Well, fuck the Razzies, because Richard E. Grant, he deserved an Academy Award nomination.
It was fucking amazing.
He is an absolute force of nature. And then we've got Sandra Bernhard coming in as well.
Clear
this up for me. Are they brother and sister, or are they man and wife?
They're man and wife.
Are they?
Well, he's English and she's American.
So...
Well, it would have been a very strange upbringing.
Yep, they might have been raised separately. I've seen that Lindsay Lohan film.
Well, John, you bring that up.
not Freaky Friday. What? Basically, they could have been separated at birth. I don't know. I always watch this. It's a very asexual relationship, just them two together. It's just, well, no, it's very sexual, but no, absolutely fantastic. We've got the auction house, we've got the Mayflowers coming in, the ambulance chase all along. That was actually filmed on the Brooklyn Bridge, that ambulance chase. We're obviously going through this film bit for bit. If you haven't seen it by now, fuck you, you should have done. That ambulance film all along, and all apparently he was ad-libbing and coming up with a lot of his own lines. That's, you know, what I've read in one place, but all along, so the catching the cigarettes, ooh, menthol, throwing them back again, proper boy New Jersey banter.
What's the chances that he would get the correct change into the toll booth as well? What the chances?
But he can't, and I just love his staring at his hair and his brand new tuxedo. I mean, again, this tells you what kind of guy Hudson Hawk is. How many other people at that auction house did you see wearing a tuxedo? Not one. Hawk will go out there and buy himself a tuxedo for a charity auction house. I think it was fun. Anyway, he's on there, and then we come along. We get to the main. I think this is the start of Act Two, isn't it? The CIA arrive. James Coburn as George.
James Coburn,
never better. Never better. Yeah, he's done, you know.
Magnificent Seven was quite good.
Magnificent Seven was decent. Yeah, okay, fair enough. Apart from that, what else has James Coburn ever been? Apart
from nothing. Nothing.
Exactly. Comes in, suddenly, bang, CIA plot twist. We've got the candy bars.
Mm-hmm.
Did you recognise anyone apart from Kit Kat?
Yeah, I recognised David Caruso and... Butterfinger, I know that he was Christopher Walken's son in Batman Returns.
Yep. Do you know who else he was?
I know that. No.
Zangief in Street Fighter. The 1994 Jean-Claude
Van Damme. Oh, fuck yeah!
Yeah, he was Zangief. And again, recognised him from that. I recognised him from, recognised him from Street Fighter, Hudson Hawk, and then a few days later, but I only clicked the other day with Batman Returns. I was like, who the hell's this guy? Absolutely clicking on, but it's him. Tried to look for him on Twitter and stuff, he's just disappeared off the face of the earth. I don't know why. When you've got films like Street Fighter and Hudson Hawk under your belt, you stick with it, don't you?
I do remember something about him, though, from a while ago. I remember he was the new Leatherface in the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Yeah.
I remember when Gunnar Hansen died, like he either tweeted or he put some shit on Facebook, you know, going like crying emojis or something like that there when he died, you know, being very glib about it. And then like a fucking shitstorm came down from him from the horror community. And they were like, how fucking dare you, you know, do stuff like this. And he tried to cover it up by saying something like, you know, they were on the convention circuit together and Gunnar Hansen was like being mean or rude about him or something like that there. Like, just some bullshit. Yeah. But still, it still doesn't take away from the fact that he was fantastic as Butterfinger.
It was fantastic. It was fantastic. You need that, you know, the big off. And again, I'm going back. Bond movie henchman. I mean, yeah, he didn't have the same charisma as Jaws, as Richard Kiel, but...
And he has possibly the best line in the movie. Do you remember what that was?
He had a lot of lines I love in that movie.
You want me to rape them?
That's it. I didn't want to say it. No Butterfingers. I don't want you to rip.
There are lines in movies that you remember, right? And when I was growing up, when I was younger, there are two lines and two sentences in Hudson Hawk that I remember. One is obviously, you want me to rape them? Because back when I was younger, I didn't know what rape meant. And I had to look it up. And imagine my shock when I looked it up and found out what rape was. Yeah, that was a whole new world that I entered into.
Imagine your parents walking into that room. There's you sat with a dictionary. 10-year-old Cormac.
I'm only studying about rape. What?
No, I want to be a rapper.
The second one was Richard E. Grant when he says, them photoman assholes. And it's they have two lines, and they've stayed with me since 1993, since I first saw this movie.
Do you know the one for me was, I even watched it back now, it still sticks with me. Right at the beginning, they're doing Da Vinci's doing all his stuff, and he's obviously he's painting the mouth last on the Mona Lisa, because that's what Leonardo would do. And just as they make the gold, you're hearing all these, hey, hey, ah, mamma mia. And then you just see one guy go, gold.
Gold, yeah.
And it's just so strong.
He's gone, gold.
And it's just like, hang on a minute, I don't think the American audience are going to understand the Spanish for the Italian for gold, so we're going to have to throw some English in. Gold? By Jove, he's only gone and made bloody gold. So we're in Rome. Enter our next twist. Now, again, I love this film. She gets a lot of stick.
Oh, hold on. Are you going to badmouth Andy McDowell?
I'm not saying she was miscast.
I'm not having it. I won't have it. I won't have it. Andy McDowell, okay. Maybe, just maybe, a little smidgen, wee bit wooden, wee tiny bit. Not that much, but Andy McDowell, I see as the bridge character in this movie.
She is the outsider. She is the audience. But she isn't, because she's part of a CIA cover-up. Yeah, she's bridging between the Vatican and the CIA, while Darwin and Minerva Mayflower are trying to take over the world. Get to grips with it. Look, Cormac, if you're not going to fucking take this seriously, don't bother doing it.
But I think that's part, you know, this, obviously talking we're having, right? I think this is the problem sometimes that people had with us. And I think that this is the, like, obviously, everybody knows that everyone has Hudson Hawk in the top 10 worst films of all time, blah, 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 top 10 worst performing movies of all time. Number one, it wasn't. Number two, it wasn't. You know, everyone just believes that. I think it came at a time when we talked about Star Wars fatigue at the start of the show. And I think people started to have a little bit of Bruce Willis fatigue around this time, you know, because he was pumping movies out since Die Hard, like two, three a year. You know, he was hitting them hard, you know, all the time. And, you know, he was married, you know, he just got married to Demi Moore. He was starting to go out with Demi Moore, you know, and everybody was waiting to cut the feet from underneath him. And yeah, okay, sometimes when you're a movie star or whatever, you get delusions of grandeur, and, you know, you start, you know, thinking that, you know, things are better than what they are and stuff like that there. But I genuinely believe, and I watched this movie like twice in the last week, I, this movie has an awful lot of heart. You know, it has an awful lot of heart.
It has. And like I say, I keep going on about the comedy aspect and the romance and this and the other. From what I've read about this, and I'm not professing myself to be there and being an expert on it, but the fact is, this film was made with Bruce Willis saying, I want to be more of a, I want to put more comedy into what I do. I don't just want to be an action star all the time. I want to do something a little bit different. I want to be creative. Like I say, he wrote the story for this, him and Robert Kraft. And they advertised it. I watched three trailers for this, like the sad get I am. Two of them were very action heavy, and it was only the third one that was more like it was a Rat Pack trailer, you know, for the old Dean Martin Sinatra sort of stuff, which I get with the soundtrack. And that's very much, and that's what happened at the time. People go into it thinking, I want to see a Bruce Willis action film. Because we've just been to see Last Boy Scout and Die Hard 2. And now here comes Hudson Hawk. And they didn't know what to make with it. And then after this, he sort of did, well, he did Death Becomes Her. And, well, Look Who's Talking was just before that. But it was already starting to go into more comedic stuff. It just didn't make the money. And I think, and that's what really let it down, because it is a cracking film. Yeah. I've just looked there. It made $18 million worldwide. They don't have the international numbers on a budget of about 60.
I think the budget, I think, said it was 67. In America, it did 18, but worldwide, it did 98, I believe. I think it was 98.
All right, I just looked on Box Office Mojo and it... Sorry, I just looked on Box Office Mojo and it didn't have the international...
I think us, obviously us Europeans have a more cultured taste when it comes to Bruce Willis action comedy movies. Of course. But I mean, I think part of the reason why it did so bad, part of the reason why it was reviewed so bad, was because there was a lot of suspension of disbelief kind of things in these movies. You know, things happened, you know, after the auction room heist, you know, him and Tommy at the top of the building, and the guy fires the gun, Big Stan fires the gun and hold the crotch, and they jump off the building, and Hudson obviously goes through the tarp and lands in the room with Mario Brothers and Alfred. And, you know, yeah, and I think a lot of people looked at that back then as, oh, that's just a cheat. That's just a cheat, you know, that they just didn't want to explain how, you know, what happened, you know. And I don't think that that's what it was meant to be. I think it was supposed to be a little bit irreverent. I think it was supposed to be a little bit mystical, or just something like that, you know, just to be different.
Yeah, end of the day, it's a jump cut, if you want to look at it, and it was a very convenient one, but the jump and land on the tarpaulin, next thing you know, he's being thrown in a chair. Now, do we need to see a film where the Mario Brothers walk out of that room, see Hudson lying on the tarpaulin or the tent or whatever, pick him up and drag him inside? No, we don't need to see it. And because it is a very lean film.
It's an hour and
35 minutes. It absolutely flies by. But if you go into this thinking, I want to watch a serious piece of drama set in the CIA and Vatican undercover fuck off. If you want to watch a film about a cat burglar getting into all sorts of capers, go ahead and laugh your ass off. Absolutely. When we're in Rome, we get the shocking twist again. Spoiler alert if you haven't seen this in the last 30 years. But we find out that our friend Tommy, Danny Aiello, is actually in with the Mayflowers.
Bastard.
I was hurt at that point. I was hurt. I thought, how could you do this to us? Well, Tommy. How could you do that?
My first thought is I knew he couldn't do it to Hudson. I knew he couldn't. I knew it was an angle.
It's not happening. It's not happening.
I was a very smart 9-year-old ball, all right.
You just turn the TV off,
Me and my brother did a lot of philosophy lessons in front of the fireplace in Cattesview Park in Oma. We did a lot of talking about this movie, you know.
I'm going to go look up more dangerous words in the dictionary. I'm out of here. Fuck this, I'm gone. But that scene, we've got the Mayflowers. Sandra Bernhard never looking better, by the way. Who do we have around the table? The Bond villains. Yeah. We've got a small child, small Indian child.
The Indian child.
I don't know what he was doing there. I'm like, has he come to the wrong meeting?
maybe we should be saying Southeast Asian, or we don't know if he was Indian or if he was from Pakistan or whatever. Like, you know, Asian. He was an Asian youth.
Asian youth.
Yeah, you know the way the
World
British
War
government
could have got a very freedom. Different.
Anyway, an Asian young Asian boy was at this table. Yes, I've changed it now. I've changed it from youth to boy. All right. Youth made it sound like he was some kind of offender,
you know what? Your missus is going to be in your next room, and all you're going to hear is you just going, "Young Asian boy."
He's at it again.
He's bidding on eBay.
I'm more worried about the neighbours.
Right. Anyway. Moving on, we get to We get to, we're still in Italy, I think, when the candy bars come back round. I mean, timed missile launches. That could only be going one way.
Awesome.
Paralyzing darts. This is a Bond film. I'm sorry. This is a Bond film. Paralyzing darts. We've got timed missiles. I mean, the way he took Snickers out was fantastic. When he was on his head, that shook me to my core as a child. Absolutely shook me to my core. I'm watching that thinking, he can't get it off his head. It's stuck to his head. It's going to go off. Oh my, it's probably what's caused a lot of my anxiety in my adult life, to be honest.
Can I say another line that I absolutely adored in this movie? Is when Anna Baragli and the Cardinal are walking through, Andy McDowell is explaining, you know, what's going on to the Cardinal, and the Cardinal turns around to Anna McDowell and says, "The Pope said I should never trust the CIA." Because it was John Paul, it was Pope John Paul back then, and so I'm just
he was the good one.
He was like, watch out for those CIA bastards. Hey. Fucking don't trust them as far as you can throw them, boy.
Just jump on the second, just sat there. I tell you what, boy.
Pope John Paul was not from Poland, he was from Tyrone. Did I ever tell you the story about my granny going to see Pope John Paul? Did I ever tell you that story?
You probably did, but go on. Is it to do with a young Asian boy?
Maybe. We'll get there. So the Pope came to Ireland, and he was in Phoenix Park in Dublin. That's where Dublin Zoo is. And I think there was about 30 to 40,000 people turned up. And the word has it that the Pope went past the crowd and touched people, and my granny said that the Pope touched her hand and she fainted.
Right. Like a girl at a Michael Jackson concert.
Literally an 80-year-old woman was touched by another 80-year-old man on the hand and she fell over. Conscious. Unconscious. That's the power of the Pope. Also, my granny was in the CIA.
At least you weren't going to say she was into yoga. Anyway.
Proud bitch.
So, we get to Da Vinci's house.
Mm-hmm.
The final level. Did you ever play the NES Hudson Hawk game?
Do you know what? I never did. And I only found out that there was a game out. It was after about maybe 5 years after the movie came out. And because it was around that time, like when we were growing up, my parents didn't have two pennies to rub together.
Yeah.
And it was one Christmas. Me and my brother used to have an Amstrad CPC 464 color monitor up in our bedroom, right? Rolling on the ropes, Rockstar at my hamster, you know, rolling in the caves, you know, all this jazz. And one day we came home from school and it wasn't there. And my dad told us that he'd sold it for drinking money.
Oh, God.
And it absolutely broke me and my brother's heart. But, you know, what can you do? What can you do? There's nothing you can do. Whatever, it was sold, it was gone now. And that Christmas, though, we got a Super Nintendo. He'd sold it to get some money to get the Super Nintendo.
Oh, wow.
Short-term loss for a long-term gain. You know, that's the way you got to look. The Mullen household, but it was amazing. But yeah, so I missed the game simply because we had a Super Nintendo and it never came out in a Super Nintendo.
We had it for the NES, and you obviously played it as Hudson. And I remember there were all these levels. You had the auction house level. You had, I think, one in the Vatican, one in the Louvre, and then one in the Darwin's thing at the end. There were, I think, little terrier dogs, bunny, ball, running at you, trying to bite your bollocks off. Security guards coming in.
Was Richard E. Grant in the video? Or in the video
No,
game?
Was it hell? I don't even think he was in the promotional tour of the movie.
I was about to give it a wee bit of a complaint there. Oh, he'll happily accept the video game money and he'll happily accept the wage.
There was like a final boss, which I'm assuming it was Richard E. Grant, but the likeness wasn't what you imagined it to be. And it was just...
So Richard Grant said, take my fucking life and likeness off this game before I sue the shit out of you.
Damn, photoman assholes.
And photoman assholes.
And he was just firing tennis balls at you out the tennis ball launcher. So you had to like jump over them and run and hit him. And thinking back, it was about four levels long. But we had that. It was absolutely... Anyway, moving on. So, yeah, I just remember that because that final level was like... It was just one of the side scrollers that you had to keep marching on through. Now, we get onto the final. Again, another song.
Mm-hmm.
Of course. Side by Side.
Mm-hmm.
A classic.
Great song. And it worked so well.
It did. It absolutely did. And again, I've spoken to so many people that scoff of it. Say, oh, why would there be singing going around? Why the fuck not?
Could it have been a musical, Paul? I know we spoke about Labyrinth last week. Could it have been a musical?
How many songs for a music? How many songs need to be a musical?
I would say five. Five.
I haven't really thought about it, but I will say five. I haven't
thought about it, but yeah. 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 Well, Labyrinth had, what, three songs? So we didn't class that as a musical. No. This one had two.
Yeah,
two.
Well, three if you count. Three if you count Minerva Mayflower's rendition of "I've Got the Power."
I have the power. Yeah, brilliant.
Still a little.
I think that's probably one person that we just haven't spoke about as well. Sandra Bernhardt in the movie.
Yeah, well, we're going to come on to Sandra. Don't worry about that. We're going to come on to Sandra. Put her and Richard E. Grant together. I can't get over how good they were as bad guys. I really can't. And that final showdown, the final bit, we fight with... So we've got Tommy and Richard E. Grant, Darwin Mayflower in the limousine going off the cliff with the explosives on board. We've got George Kaplan and...
Alfred losing his head, you know. Yeah.
And again, if you were Bond, what would you say at that point? Because I bet it would be... I guess he's not going to that head convention in July. I just think, once you've just decapitated a man and you're running out, what's the best thing you could say?
How many times do you think Bruce Willis winked to the cameraman after he delivered that line?
I think... You like that one? How many
like that one?
while drinking his Starbucks. How many multiple takes do you think he insisted on? How many multiple takes where he'd like chop his head and goes, looks like he's not getting ahead in life. You like that one?
Looks like he's not going to the hat convention in December. Cut. No.
Cut. Bruce, we agreed on July.
Hats are for summer.
But of course, look, everyone saves the day and this, that, and the other, and look, obviously we've spoiled it, but go and watch it to really get a flavour for what a fucking insane last 20 minutes of a film this is. And we get, it's insane, it's absolutely insane. Rocket launchers, swords from sleeves, you've got limousines off cliffs, you got, mm-hmm. What else did we have?
Fucking believe it!
Thank you for that, because I wanted to come on to that. Can I not believe it? Well, Tommy, you just...
Well, all right, listen, don't dissect it, Paul. Don't dissect it, all right? Yes, we saw the limousine burst into...
fucking sprinkler systems in the back, can you fucking believe it?
No, Tommy.
Tommy.
No, if he'd have said this, right, if he'd have said this, because this is what I think what happened is, right, so it goes off the cliff, the car bursts into flames, and Tommy Five Tone gets, whoop, shot out the sunroof, right?
Because he said there were airbags in the back.
Shut up, Paul! Shut up!
He said there were airbags and sprinkler systems. I wrote it
listen
down.
Listen to me. Listen to the story. Right, so, ball of flame. Tommy gets shot out like a projectile at the sunroof, right? Yeah. So he obviously loses consciousness after hitting the sunroof. right? Cool. And then the car hits the ground, the sprinkler systems come on, the fucking airbags, stuff like that there. So he wakes up unconscious next to the car, and the sprinkler systems are on and everything. So that's what I take from it. Might be wrong.
I'll take it any damn way I can, because, again, if we're going to not question why he fell through a tarpaulin or whatever and on an outside foyer and fell into a sofa in the middle of a room, and we're not going to question how gold gets changed from lead and this, that, and the other, then we're not going to question how Tommy Fivetoe gets survived.
Science. That's how it happens. Science
and magic. Is...
and magic.
Science and magic.
Imagine.
Are you reading the cliff notes from the script at the minute? How did you get out of the cab?
Script, all the movie was ad-libbed, and it was just said, science and magic, ladies. That's all it said.
Bruce Willis does shit. The end.
Yeah, Bruce Willis punches people and sings songs. Science and magic.
We're just gonna follow Bruce around for a day and see what happens. I'm just looking here, then we get yeah, Lando McDowell just shows up. can I have a job? The was and then at the end again, nice bringing it back round again. He gets his cappuccino at the end, and again, that's how you bookmark a film. That is how you bookend an absolute classic piece of cinema.
But I will say one thing, right? I will say this, okay?
Yeah.
Now, I've had many takeaway cappuccinos in my life. I am quite continental that way, Paul. Now, he gets a cappuccino at the start of the movie. Tommy gives him the cappuccino at the start of the movie. And the foam comes off the top. Never has a coffee been ruined for me by foam coming off the top.
Well, he spilt it. He spilt it in the car at first.
He only spilt the foam.
Well, he spilt it, and then he said it had the perfect amount of foam. But the foam is the milk. The foam is the cappuccino, Cormac.
No,
so if you spill the foam... Right. Text in, 87453, it's a cappuccino.
I've never had a fucking cappuccino!
I've made plenty of them in my life. You've got a shot of espresso, and then some milk on the top foamed up. If the foam goes, you lose the... You're just drinking an espresso then. What's the point in that? So, Mark's out of 10 for Hudson Hawk?
10.
10, of course. Of course. We would go to 11, but that is not possible. Couple of afterthoughts on the film. As you know, if you follow us on Twitter, and I let you know this week, we reached out to some of the stars of this film. Namely, Rich D. Grant and Sandra Bernhard, asking for their thoughts.
and guess who didn't reply?
Well, Richard apparently was busy, but Sandra Bernhard, an absolute star and a gem. I will not have a bad word said about her ever again. I tweeted her just saying, look, we're doing the podcast. Any chance you could tell us a few thoughts on how it was making this film. Sandra actually replied within about 20 minutes, I think. I don't think she's got much off. Imagine being in Rome for 3 months and Budapest right after the wall fell. It was incredible. Richard E. Grant and I had a blast, and they don't make them like that anymore. Hashtag Hudson Hawk. And
I think it's one of those things that's probably a testament to her character and a testament to herself that she takes a positive from a massive, well, I'll put negative in air quotes, you know, because let's not forget that she was panned for being in this movie as well. Yeah. You know, she got a Razzie nomination, you know, so I know now that actors, you know, go to collect their Razzie and stuff and make a joke of it and things like that there, you know, but back in, you know, when she went in this movie, you know, she wasn't in Roseanne at this point. I think she joined Roseanne around 92, 93, maybe.
A bit later, mid-90s, you know,
yeah, and she was in, you know, King of Comedy with Scorsese and things like that there, you know, and, you know, she was in, you know, the odd movie, whatever. But, you know, Sandra Bernhardt in this movie, you know, she's up there with Richard E. Grant for me. You know, she had this kind of weird sexuality about her.
Oh yeah.
And you know, yeah. and it was one of those ones where I didn't know how to take her. You know, it was the voice, and you know, and her kind of, she was so confident. And it was kind of, it's not hard to understand that Sandra Bernhardt was one of the first, you know, openly lesbian characters on TV, you know, because fuck you, because that's Sandra Bernhardt. You know, that's just how her personality is. You know, fuck you. I'm going to do what I want. I will do what I want. And again, it's a testament to her character that, you know, we're two boys that met 15 years ago and just decided a couple of years back to start chatting about movies and general rubbish, you know, maybe on a podcast. And, you know, she answered back.
She did. And you know what? I've got much, and we're having a chat about this, and this is something we've come up with. The fact that she's answered back, the fact that she gives that respect to reply to us, and she gave such a really positive, heartfelt answer. We are going to place Sandra Bernhardt onto, drum roll.
That's a shitty drum roll, sorry. Hold on. Two seconds, right? You ready?
Okay, wait, come on. Okay, go.
Okay, right. Clear my throat, but no, I'm not using my throat. Can you hear that? Can you hear that?
Oh, I can't hear that. This has gone for a drum roll into you doing a drum solo.
But I'm just, baby. No, I was going to second that. I just thought I'd say that too.
We are placing Sandra Bernhardt onto the Don Cheadle A-List. This is an exclusive platform where people can only get on by either you or me, Cormac. And the Movie Chef podcast is going to honour those people who we want to honour, who shows that bit of that respect, reply back to us, and those people who've been in them films that we hold dearest to our heart. So, Sandra, come on in. Welcome to the Don Cheadle A-List. Thank you very much for that, Drew.
I do have a quiz for you, all right?
Yep, I'm going to say, you got any more thoughts? Go ahead, I love a quiz.
You know I like a quiz. So, Hudson Hawk obviously got me thinking about movies that were critically panned or movies that had really bad reviews at the time, but then later on they come out as being classics.
Yep.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read you out 5 reviews and you're going to guess what movie it is, okay?
Okay.
So, number one. Most of these come from the New York Times for some reason. I don't know why. Okay. Number one. A dumb movie that could have been made only by an intelligent and talented man.
A dumb movie that could have really been made by an intelligent man. Something like A Beautiful Mind?
No. Apocalypse Now.
Give over.
A dumb movie that could only have been made by an intelligent... That was by Richard T. Jameson from The Weekly. Now, that was the only one that's not from the New York Times. Okay, number two.
Richard T. Jameson is never getting on the Don Cheadle A-List.
Never?
Never.
Okay, number two. With the seductive tracking shots and the repetitive music, the film stops and starts so many times before anything happens that the bogeyman turning up just gets to be a nuisance. So with the seductive tracking shots and the repetitive music, Halloween. The film stops and starts... Oh, bang on, my man! Uh-huh. That was by Pauline Kael from the New York Times. Pauline, so, number three... I know, you don't know fuck all. Number three. A chunk of elegant occultist, claptrap. The devil, it seems, for all his supposed powers, can't break and enter without sounding like Laurel and Hardy trying to move a piano. A chunk of elegant occultist claptrap. The devil, it seems, for all his supposed powers, can't break and enter without sounding like Laurel and Hardy trying to move a piano.
The devil, it seems, kind of... No, go on.
That was The Exorcist.
Right, okay.
Fenton Camby of the New York Times. Number.
Can't enter without sound line. Imagine that on Exorcist. The power of Christ compels you.
Number four. Everything of interest was thoroughly covered in the original film, but like many people who have nothing to say, part two won't shut up.
I've watched the recent, I'm going to guess Godfather.
That is the Godfather part two, yeah. Part and that's two, from yeah. the same person. That's from Vincent Cambry of the New York Times. He doesn't like movies.
Okay. Moving forward, well, we won't be having any more reviews from the New York Times.
Here's another one. Funny enough, it's Vincent Campy from the New York Times.
This episode is sponsored by Vincent Campy from the New York Times.
This is just a character assassination of Vincent Campy. Okay. It's a measure of how the film operates that not once do we feel particular sympathy for any of the victims. It puts good actors to the test. They have to work very hard just to appear alive. It's a measure of how the film operates that not once do we feel particular sympathy for any of the victims. It puts good actors to the test. They have to work very hard just to appear alive.
Titanic?
That was Jaws.
Jaws. Right, okay. I got the water. It was watery.
You, Vincent Camby. You got it. Yeah. But, you know, I think what this kind of says is I am in no way putting this critically, you know, up there with any of those movies. But what I will say is there are some movies where you take your brain out and you put it at the door. And that's what I do with movies like Hudson Hawk. You take your brain out, put it at the door, and you fucking enjoy the movie.
Yeah. I very rarely will go to a cinema or sit down to watch a film and think, come on, test me. Yeah. I want to go through the ringer here. No, I learned at uni that watching films is escapism. I do not want realism in my Batman films. I do not want realism. The fact that I am watching this film and drinking my alcohol and doing whatever I'm doing is because I do not want to experience real life. Why the fuck would I want to turn on my TV and watch Batman sat there fucking suicidal over his parents or something and not wanting to go fight crime? Fuck up, you're Batman. Go and get out there and do what you're supposed to do. Kick ass. Chew bubble gum. That's, yeah, damn absolutely. Right. Hudson Hawk.
That's Ready Roddy
Piper. You are.
That's Ready Roddy Piper.
That is, yeah.
You're Ready Roddy.
But, no, look, Hudson Hawk, you know what? It's a cult classic. It will be resigned to one of those. And some people will scoff at it. And those people are wrong. And if you watch it for what it is, you will have a lot of fun with this film. Give it another chance. Go and buy the 4K Blu-ray Hudson Hawk right now, as soon as...
Sandra Bernhard.
And have you got any more thoughts on this film?
No, not really. I mean, I think again, it's all about perspective as to what you want out of a movie. For me, you know, it's all about, you know, are you going into a movie to just assassinate it straight away? Are you going into a movie just to straight away dislike it? Are you going into a movie, you know, with an open mind? And I think that's why Hudson Hawk kind of worked for me. You know, there's a lot of movies out there. There's a lot of movies out there that people hated and I actually quite liked. Sucker Punch is another one. I actually quite like Sucker Punch. I get all the you know, the sexist undertones and stuff like that. Yeah, I get it. I see it. You know, I do understand it. But, you know, sometimes you just can't go into a movie just expecting things. I think that's probably the problem what this movie had. You know, I don't think even the people who were marketing the movie knew what the movie was.
No.
I don't think they understood, you know, did they want a comedy? Did they want an action movie? You know, did they want another Die Hard? Did they want a franchise? You know, did they want, there was just so much that was involved in it, you know, and I think everything got lost in this whole kind of narrative of Bruce Willis. And I think that's where it all went. You know, everybody seen it as a vanity project. Oh, look at this dickhead throwing millions and millions of pounds and changing the script and things. You know, not once did I read anything about Hudson Hawk, about bar Richard E. Grant, you know, complaining about, you know, the production and stuff like that there. Everybody else, you know, seemed to enjoy it enough, you know.
And we're going back to the movie chef theme of the podcast. If somebody puts a plate of food in front of me and I enjoy that plate of food, I don't give a shit how many people were fighting in the kitchen and how many times the first one burnt and, you know, how difficult was it getting the food prepped and ready on time. I don't care. As long as what's in front of me is tasty and acceptable and good fun and enjoyable, then I'm happy. And Hudson Hawk was that. Would you want to see a sequel? Do you think they could do a sequel after all the time? Because
Son of Hawk.
Son of Hawk. Yes, who would be Son of Hawk?
Who would be? Oh, fuck, you've got me on the spot here now. Who would be a young Bruce Willis?
Ryan Gosling.
Nah.
Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
Looper.
We've already seen him as a... Yeah.
No. Somebody from left field. I'm thinking somebody fatter. Maybe it's somebody
fatter than 1% body fat Joseph Gordon-Levitt. Okay, let's think of anybody fatter than that.
I'm talking about somebody who's got a bit of beef. Maybe like
Channing Tatum.
What do you call the guy at a court? No. What do you call the guy at Coronation Street? The cop with the ginger hair who keeps switching the lights off. Not him.
I haven't watched Coronation Street in 8 years.
The guy's got OCD and he keeps switching lights off.
I still haven't seen it. Is that as good as Coronation Street? Fucking hell. Coronation Street, the lockdown episodes.
It's like a big ginger cop and he flicks lights off. I'd like to see him as a young Hudson Hawk. I think it'll be a great career move for him.
Imagine the guy. What have I got at the minute? Flicking light switches on and off on Coronation Street. What have you been offered? Son of Hawk. Where's the light switches?
But who would? Do you know what that means? That's a good question. Who nowadays could pull off what Richard E. Grant and Sandra Bernhardt do? Is there actors around nowadays that could pull that off? That bombastic kind of Will's Neil and I, you know, that bombastic, you know, how to get ahead in advertising, you know, that bombastic, you know, Mayflowers, Hudson Hawk. Who could do it?
Steve Coogan, I think so. Maybe not the bombastic type, but I think he could play the slithering bad guy.
Yeah. I get that. I do understand that. But, you know, from minute one, when Grant and Sandra Bernhardt came onto the screen, like they chewed up the scenery, like they chewed it up.
Yeah,
I can't think off the top of my head another actor or another actress who could put that level of tenacity into a scene and get away with it.
I know one. Who's your man from Community? The Dean.
Who's a man from what?
Community. The Dean. Jim.
Oh, Jim Rash?
Jim Rash. Imagine him being given that role to go for. I mean, I know it's typecasting a bit with how he is, but you know, in that sort of flamboyant, eccentric, really throw yourself into a role. I don't know. It's one for another. We'll do a sequels episode one time and we'll talk sequels. You know what? I just thought watching this, I just, you know, when you just said Son of Hawk, the first thing that I had was candy bars, Hawk 2, something like that. Another CIA mission with some new candy bars. I think that'd be fantastic. And of course, Hawk can get found out halfway along and whatever. Anyway, you got anything more to say?
No.
No, well, that's it. Well, it's goodbye from you.
Bye.
And it's goodbye for me. We're going to go drink some cappuccino and play Nintendo. See you later.
a star, carry moonbeams home in a jar, and be better off than you are. Or would you rather be a mule? A mule is an animal with long, funny ears. He kicks up at anything he hears. His back is brawny and his brain is weak. He's just plain stupid with a stubborn streak. And by the way, if you hate to go to school, you may grow up to be a mule. How would you like to swing on a star, carry moonbeams home in a jar, and be better off than you are? Or would you rather be a pig? Hey, a pig is an animal with dirt on his face.